I have great pleasure in bringing to you this sister based on the tradition of all these sisters which she introduced us to. If you have the flyer, you'll see a whole list of sisters. She's just one of them. Sisters and brothers from the land that gave you a revolution that is still unfinished.
Right.
Our sister, Baina Bello.
Liberation fighters, visible and invisible, those that we read about in history books, and those that were presented to us as mythological beings, as gods, as divinities, the name of all of us who were in all the forms that we were before, united with us today in the forms that we are now, united with us tomorrow in the forms that we will be by our will. I greet you in ancient traditional terms, One. The reply is respect. Hi, One. Yes, in Haiti, traditionally, we say "one" when we come somewhere, which means I come with honor. And those who receive us say respect, which means we receive you with respect. So greeting at home when IT was IT was a matter of honoring and respecting each other. Today we gave this up for health. Oh. And indeed, we are living in it.
Hell, that's right.
We thank those who run African Echoes, who struggle and battle each week to find people who have something to say, to come and share with those who want to hear something. We thank all those who come and take a little time from the rat race to come and be in the family and be with each other so we can find out who we are and who we ought to be. Tonight, we're going to look at Bodu. What is, Brother Inumi said, Bodu is a religion. I'm not so sure. As a matter of fact, I'm pretty sure it's not. For after analyzing the word religion and the practice of religions around this world today, I have come to understand religion is the business of selling that which you cannot see. And it's good business. The Catholics have done it. Muslims have done it. Protestants do it. Mormons do it. They sell to us and we buy and pay dearly that which we cannot see. Religions usually go after convincing people that they must be part of this religion if they want to be saved, if they want to save their soul. Religions usually say, if you're not part of my group, you're no good. You belong to the devil. And Vodou doesn't say that. Vodou doesn't care if you go to church, if you go to the temple, or go to the mosque. It doesn't matter to Voodoo. You can go anywhere you want. And Voodoo is still, it's all right with Voodoo. And if we look at the word Voodoo, we learn that it means the spirit is present. Be aware that the spirit is present. In all that you do, know that the spirit is present. It doesn't sell you a spirit with a particular name. It doesn't tell you, unless you call the spirit Jesus or Allah or anything else, then you will be damned. No. Voodoo is very comfortable. And it is so true. In Africa, it was known as Ifa. And you learned about Esu Elegba. When you come to Haiti, we call it Voodoo. And we say Legba. When we go to Cuba, we talk about Santeria. We talk about Obeah. We talk about Lukumi. All these are children of Ifa. And we find the principles remain the same, though the details may change. What is important is to know the principle. And most of all, as many of the Ungan at home say to me, when I ask what is the most important thing about Voodoo, they say, well, you don't have to go somewhere, stick out your tongue, so they will put God in you. In Voodoo, God is already there. You just have to know how to call on Him and say, come on, I need this work done. You don't have a special day. There is no Saturday that is a special day, or Friday that is a special day, or Tuesday or Monday or any other day. Voodoo says, you must be aware of the presence of the Spirit. Every minute, every second, in every thought, every word, and every action of yours. You are not a practicing Voodoo on Sunday, and then on Tuesday you go kill people, on Friday you go steal, on Wednesday you go murder, and then on Sunday you are pure. No, Voodoo does not recognize that. Your purpose, Voodoo says, on this earth, is to build good character. Our purpose as human beings is to build good character, so we can create a worthwhile society and have a life of victory. So, how does one build good character? To build good character, Voodoo give us a number of principles. Many places, NIT included, we have a tendency to take a principle and say there's a God. People talk about the God Legba, the God Aizan, God so-and-so. But that's not the word the ancestors gave us. The ancestors gave us the word Lua. The white folks wrote it. L-O-A. But in the French language, there is also the word Lua. But white folks write it L-O-E, L-O-I. Their Lua is written L-O-I. Our Lua is written L-O-A. Both are pronounced the same way. Both means the same thing. And what is the meaning of the word loi in French? It means law in English. So if they tell us we have the Legba loi, how can it become God? Or is it that a law is a God? Question. So let's look at a couple of the principles, the laws that Voodoo give us for a life of victory. Number one, many times we learn about Dum in Africa. In Haiti we call it Dumbala. Dumbala represented by what? How is it represented? What form does it have? Dumbala or Dum? Anyone here knows?
Excuse me? The snake. Yes. The form of a snake. Why? That is the law of life. The law of basic biological material life. And it tells us the law, in order to have life in a biological material form, you must have flexibility and mobility. If there is no flexibility, there is no life. If there is no mobility, there is no material life, biological material life. So why is it represented by a snake? Well, let's see. Which animal do we know of that is more flexible and has greater mobility than the snake? The snake lives in the desert. The snake lives in the water. It lives on the tree. It lives underground. It lives in the forest. It lives inside the human body or animal body. There is no place the snake will not live because it has tremendous flexibility and tremendous mobility. It could go anywhere and it can adapt to any situation. It does not die. It survives all transitions or new environments. It adapts. It doesn't die. As a matter of fact, we know that there are many types of snakes. Even when you cut them in half, what happens? The head will grow another tail. It's a very difficult animal to destroy. That is why this animal represents the very principle of life, flexibility and mobility. In Haiti we call Dambala. In Africa it is called Dog. But this is just, remember we said, the principle of life. Now we come into the first principle for social life. First principle for social life, that means interaction between humans, is Legba. In Africa, Esu Elegba. In Haiti, Legba. In analyzing those words, Esu Elegba, we learn that Esu means the divine interpreter. And Elegba means the one who fights. The battleman, the military guy, the one who can defend situations. So, does it make sense that in IET, when Ifa came to IET and gave birth to Voodoo, in choosing a name for the very first principle between Esu and Elegba, in the situation that we were in, what is it logical that we should choose? Legba. Because we were in the battleground. We were fighting for freedom, for life. So Legba is the dominant term in Haiti. Esu is the dominant term in other parts of Africa. Legba is the principle, the first, we say, first principle of social life, social interaction. And what is that principle? It is to create opportunity for others. We say it at home, we say opening the door. When you open the door, do you open it for yourself or do you open it for others? If you open it for yourself, it's just you. You come to the door, you open it. Nobody knows that you open the door and it doesn't matter. If opening the door is important, it's because you open the door to let somebody else go by. Huh? So Elegba is the law which demands, in order to have a society, people must have as a first principle, create an opportunity for the others. Give the other one, put the other one first. Give your brother a chance. Help your sister advance. That is the principle of Legba. When you're talking about Legba, when you pronounce this word, that's what it carries. That it means if you understand, if you say you serve Legba, and you're always standing in the middle of a doorway, and people can't go through, there's something wrong with what you say, between what you say and what you do. There's no harmony between what you say and what you do. If you believe in Legba, and you are a servant of Legba, that means the principle is embodied in you, and you act upon this principle, then automatically, if there is a problem here, we all need to get out of this room, then the dominant Legba among us, all of us have the principle in us, but the one that has it as a dominant character will be the one that you hold the door. Say, brothers and sisters, this way, that way, and maybe this person will not ever go through this door. But this person will make sure that everybody else get out of the endangered area. That is a Legba. Legba is not some spooky little something that's going to crawl up in the form of a snake that we need to adore. When we take our own language, we understand that we say we serve a loi. Word for word, that's what we say. We do not say we adore a loi. There is no adoring in Vodun. There is servicing, giving service, putting your word into action, acting upon a principle, but not adoring. Okay. So Legba, first law, first principle for social principle for a good society, a life of victory. Second one, we must develop, remember, the purpose of Vodun, to develop, to build good character. We came here to build good character. That means, do I sit down and I wait to see how I'm going to become somebody with good character? No. I'm supposed to build good character. I have to work on myself to put in myself the character traits that are necessary for a good society, for a life of victory. So I must, yeah, I'm told, the first principle I must know and must apply and must act upon is Legba. Number two is Aizen. Aizen is the principle of organization and structure. You must know how to organize. Two people cannot coexist in a common space if there is no law, no rules, no organization. There has to be. So Aizen is that principle of organizing. And all these, the principles, Legba is a male principle. Aizen is a female principle. And Aizen is Legba's wife. So that means you must, that's your first duty, is to create opportunity for others. But it cannot be done in chaos. It must be organized. It must be structured. It must be measured. There must be degrees to everything. Aizen, they tell us, created music. What is music? Sound put into precise degrees, measures, density. Everything is taken into account. Specific, detailed, precisions. That's what organization is all about. So we have Legba, then we have Aizen.
Brother, sister. Spell that.
A-Y-I-Z-A-N. Third principle for social, third social principle for a life of victory is Ogun. Ogun. O-G. G is the Latin George. Is G or J? That's G. O-G-O-U-N. Ogun. Ogun is the principle of courage. Once you know your duty, create opportunity for others to help life flow, to advance, to bring progress in the life of a people. You must create opportunity for others. Number two, you must organize your actions. Number three, you must have courage. There is no life if there is no courage. Ogun is the principle of courage. And Vadum goes further and explains to us, what is courage made of? Courage is made of truth, spoken with an objective that is good for a community. Not any old kind of truth. You must speak the truth. No one. If you cannot speak the truth, you have no courage. When you are courageous, you speak the truth. This brother is bigger and taller than I am. If he asked me, sister, do you think I'm the most good-looking man on this earth with his gun on his in his hand? I must tell him, no, you ain't. If I pretend to be courageous, in spite of his gun, if the gun stops me, you tell me, well, have to be tactical, blah, 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 blah. I can speak the truth or I can shut up. But I have no excuse for speaking untruth if I am to be a courageous person. So courage begins with truth. And a truth spoken with what objective? To benefit a group. If I come with my gun and tell everybody here, give me your wallet, am I courageous? No, I'm a jerk who wants to steal people's money. That's not being courageous. You get confused sometimes about these things. That's not being courageous. There is no truth in what I say. And there is no objective to serve for the benefit of a large group. I'm just going to take your money and put it in my account and do something for me. It's useless action. Because me will go nowhere. I can have all the millions in the world. Any little nobody can attack me and destroy me as long as only me. But if we go together and we have millions, it will be very difficult for anybody to come and mess with any one of us. If we have no money, we have a position. It will be very difficult for anybody to come and attack one of us. When we have Ligba, we create opportunity one for the other, so we can count on each other. We have trust among ourselves. That is strength. We have ISO, organization, structure. It is difficult to come among us and buy some of us. And then we act with courage. When we act with courage, people are afraid of us. Ogun, we say, is courage. Courage is made of truth. And when you act in the benefit of a large group, that means there is justice. So we could make it in two simple words. We say Ogun is courage, and courage equal truth and justice. They come together. Fourth principle. Oshun. Oshun, Ogun, is a male principle. Oshun is a female principle. Oshun is the wife of Ogun. Oshun, people usually translate it as love. And some of us get real stupid with the meanings of love. But let's go into the doom and ask the doom to explain to us what is love. Love is harmony in a multitude of things, to create harmony in a multitude of different things. Love is to have, I can heal you. The brother is, he's different from me. He's different height, he's different skin tone, he has different outfit. I'm not frightened by the fact that he doesn't look like me. I can deal with the brother. We can interact. We are different, and we're going to find the channel through which we can communicate. Because through organization, with courage, we're going to be able to deal with things and have a base of functioning. That's what love is. Love is not doobie-doobie-doo, I love you. That is word. That is nonsense. When somebody tell you, I love you, close your eyes and say, oh brother, if you're white and you have, you know, those people have different kind of color eyes, they should close their eyes and say, what's the color of my eye? Three quarters of the time, the person who says that didn't even look at your face and don't know the color in your eyes.
I see.
Okay? Ask the person say, I love you. Tell them, what do you know about me? What do you love about me? Tell me exactly. What specifically? Is it my height? Is it my skin tone? Is it my hair? What is it you like? Be precise, brother. Yes. You should ask. And you're going to find out the person can't say very much. They never really looked at you. They don't even know you in the most superficial physical way. Now let's not get into your character. If they don't know what you look like, which their eyes is right on it, how are they going to know who you are? To love is to know many things and be able to harmonize all the differences. No knowledge, no love possible. No knowledge, no love possible. Bodo tells us we must develop, we must build good character. How do I know how to build my good character if I don't know who I am? I don't know what my weaknesses are. I don't know what my strengths are. If I don't know my weaknesses, I cannot know what my strengths are. Because I don't have the courage to speak the truth about myself to myself. I cannot know myself. And if I don't know myself, I cannot love myself. And if I don't love myself, can I love you? No way, Jose. I cannot love you. There cannot be, love cannot exist without. And if you notice, as the principle comes, it's a build on. One is a prerequisite for the other. We're not talking about that love in the mouth. We're talking about love, a powerful weapon, which is built on knowing and respecting others, having the courage to speak the truth, organizing. If you can't organize your life, what are you coming to do in my life? could come and create chaos? No, thank you. I'm very happy in my little life, well organized, just as it is. If you're going to come, that's because I see your life is well organized too. In fact, I'm going to admire your organization first. Your structure first. Not your body, your structure in your life. I'm going to be mesmerized by your courage. And that's when there's going to be love between you and I. If I see no courage, I see no truth being spoken. I don't see you being able to give even an old lady a seat in a bus. You can't open the door for a pregnant woman.
Thank you.
Why in the world would I put my entrust, my sentimental life into your hands? That is a no-no in voodoo. You must go and build good character. When you have built good character, while I'm building good character, then the two of us will have a basis for doing something together. So we saw four principles for social interaction. Legba, followed by, or side by side with, Aizan. Look at this. You must, before even knowing anything, you must create opportunity for others. Then you organize. And then you can speak. Aizan doesn't speak. She organizes worlds. She organizes universe. Ogu is gonna speak. He has the right to speak. Because there is courage. And he knows he can speak the truth. And then we come to the partner to courage. The one that's going to bring equilibrium. So that courage will not go into any excess. Oshun. Love. Comes to put it all together, to put everything in its place, allowing everything to grow and develop according to its own objective. Four, social principles. And we talked about dung, which is not a social principle, just a biological, material, essential of life. So when we look at voodoo, understanding these principles, we understand not as a religion where you come in to learn dogmas and repeat and be conditioned to react a certain way, but something that gives you a base for observing the universe through your own eyes, not somebody's program. You look at these principles and you have a duty to serve. To apply these principles. It's not words. There is no situation in voodoo where the hungong or the mambo must stand up and have a sermon and give a big speech. No, that's not what's required of them. What's required of them? I have a headache. I go to my hungong, I go to my mambo, and he's got to find a solution to my headache. Until I know enough to know to bring it myself. But if I'm new within the society, I am at the responsibility is the chief of the group. I'm hungry, my hungong, my mambo must feed me. The priest has no responsibility for your hunger. That's your business. But he will not stop telling you, put the money in the whatever there. So he can buy wine and eat fine cheese. And have rubies and all different kinds of fantastic amber jewels in every finger for different days. The Ungo has a responsibility because this is a belief system which demands service to one another. Why must we serve one another? Why? Excuse me? No, we're not put here to serve anybody else. We're put here to build good character. Why must we serve? Because it helps us to build good character. When you do something for someone else, it's not really for the person you're doing anything. You are the ultimate beneficiary. If I help you do something, I'm not doing for you. It's giving me an experience. It gives me a chance to grow. I'm building good character. That is the vision that Vodun brings to us. If I put in my head that when I help this brother, I'm helping him, or he couldn't walk, so I held him. I'm a wonderful person because I'm helping him and I'm doing something for him. And now he owes me something. Oh yes. But when I know I'm helping the brother because it will make me stronger. It will build my good character. He owes me nothing. He gave me an opportunity to build my good character. So he owes me nothing. Finished doing, forgotten. Never met the brother. Do you see the difference?
Oh yes.
Not going too fast?
No.
Take your time.
Sure? Okay. Five principles. We're coming to number six. Number six is what we call a mutant principle. All the principles we have seen before, we will find them in Africa, and we will find them all over wherever Yoruba people have gone and carried the belief system of Ifa. It will have different names in different places, like we said before, Vodum in Haiti, Lukumi in certain places in South Africa, and South America, Obia in Jamaica, Santeria in Cuba. It is the same basic Ifa belief system that has given all these different belief systems. They're not different, but they have different names. And sometimes the words change a little bit, but the principles remain the same. In IET, we'll see two other principles which you will not find in Africa. Because everything that is alive is constantly generating new situations, new concepts, new environment will bring new principles. I am certain there is a principle for representing the black men. There is a principle representing the white men. Before there can be a white man, there has to be a principle that says this thing can exist in matter. Okay? So, when white men meets black men, or white men take by force black women, and then we have what we call in IET, mulatto. So there has to be a principle that existed in order for this matter to come to our eyes. And has to be before we see it existed. Remember, everything exists first where we cannot see it. And then we will see it down the road. So we have this principle called Jaltibwa. J-A-L-T-I-B-W-A. J-A-L-T-I-B-W-A. Jaltibwa. And this principle, to the clearest way I can put it, is if you want an Ogu principle reduced to a very specific task. Jaltibwa is during the revolution in Haiti, Jean Tigran came to be as the perfect general. It is strictly a military spirit. It is there when you are in battles, there are weapons, there is a battle situation, then you're going to call on Jean Tigran in order to deal with. But he's not going to worry about where the truth is, what the objective is. He is just there for the fighting part of the situation. You see? And we can find thousands of other principles. That's why some people say, well, you can never count how many gods there are in Voodoo. Well, there are none. Or there are many. Each one of us is one. But every situation creates a new principle. A war situation will produce very specific principles. And the last one that I will mention to you is Gede. How many of you have already heard this word, Gede? G-U-E-D-E. Also, you do not find Gede in Africa. That is something that is local. And to me, Gede is, again, a legba reduced to a specific situation. Gede is the principle of facing that which you don't see or don't want to see. Gede is generally represented as a very small person. Not a child, but it has the size of a child. It's an adult with the size of a child. Gede is very contrary to established rules. Whatever, when somebody is what we call possessed by Gede, if this is a person who's very sophisticated, who only speaks French, who does things with the little finger up and whatnot, when that person is possessed by the Gede, this person becomes absolutely no more. All that sophistication is gone. In other words, Gede brings out what the person has been hiding. Whereas, in opposite situation, you will find somebody who is not very educated, who does not have a very sophisticated mannerism, generally, and when possessed by Gede, this person is now like a queen, walking, very sophisticated mannerism. Huh? So all these are principles we must understand, not gods that we must serve. Principles that we must know, understand, and apply. It means nothing if you can make a speech about Ogun for 17 hours. But if whenever you hear boom, you jump under the table, you have not learned a thing about a group. You know nothing at all. If when a question is asked, you're always looking for what is it this person wants to hear in order to fix up your answer, you know nothing about a group. You cannot pretend to be a servant of Ogun. Courage is absolutely indispensable for a good life. No courage, no good life possible. Because no courage, there is no truth. And no courage, there is no justice. Must have courage, must have truth, justice. If there is to be good life. When we observe Haiti on a purely historical ground, period of revolutionary period, we observe each hero and heroine. We can identify each one of them functioning strictly on a particular principle. When one studies Toussaint Louverture, If you don't know anything about Vadum, you cannot understand Toussaint. You can only repeat what they say about him. Let me just give you a little, let me try to give you a picture, a clearer picture. If I open any book about Ifa, when they describe Esu Elegba, they will tell me Esu Elegba is represented by a very short, skinny man, old, but very agile, very old, even crippled sometimes. But he has the agility of a young person. If you run after him, you cannot catch him. He's very fast. They will tell me that Esu Elegba is the divine interpreter. He speaks all the languages of everything that is alive. He speaks the language of the sun, he speaks the languages of humans, he speaks the languages of trees, and the languages of animals. There is nothing that he cannot speak to. Esu Elegba. They will tell me Esu is the messenger, because since he speaks all the language, he brings messages back and forth. He does the interpretation. And Esu also will defend the truth. That's the Lengba part of Esu. Okay. When I take any manual about Austria, about Toussaint Louverture, they will tell me he was a dark, ugly old man. But he was called the king of the savannah because nobody could catch him once he was on a horse. I will learn that Toussaint spoke French, he spoke English, he spoke Spanish, he spoke Haitian, he spoke Latin. He spoke the languages of all the forces at play on the scene. I will look at Toussaint's work. Toussaint was baptized by the slave masters, the slavers. He was baptized François Dominique Breda. François means a French thing or something that belongs to France. Dominique means born on a Sunday. Breda was the name of the plantation where he was born. We find that as a slave, he carried this name. As he entered into the revolution, he got rid of the François and the Dominique, became Toussaint. They say they named him Toussaint because he was born on November 1st, All Saints Day. And as he really showed himself as a determined leader in the revolution, he got rid of the Breda and people baptized him Louverture. Louverture means the one who opens the way. Toussaint Louverture, in everything that he did, a perfect Legba. And I will go further. Remember I told you in the first example this evening when I started to talk, Legba usually does not go through the door. He opens the way. He shows the way. Everybody else goes. He stays behind. What do we see? Toussaint opens the way for Haiti's independence. Toussaint shows the way for Haiti's independence. And at Independence Day, Toussaint is not there. His work was done. He could go anywhere. But in spite of everybody telling him, warning him, that is a trap, don't go to this meeting, he said, no, I must go. My work is done here. Toussaint is gone. When we study Suzanne Simon Louverture, Toussaint's wife, everyone who went to his house, we have tons of documents of all kinds of people, whether they were colonizers, whether they were black people, everyone, talking about how Toussaint's house was so well organized that no matter what time of the day or night you came, You could eat, you could find everything you needed. Even when in hiding, this woman was always admired for her capacity to regulate things so they would last till they were no longer needed. But you didn't run out of things when Suzanne was on the scene. So we find Aizan. Toussaint is gone, Aizan goes with him. Dessaline comes on the scene. When we read Yoruba literature, we learn that Ogun's function, we said his way of operating is to speak the truth for justice. But his purpose is to eliminate obstacles once an objective is set. Ogun's purpose, eliminate obstacles once an objective is set. What do we see Dessaline do on the scene? Number one, if you read anything about Dessaline, people hate this man and they detest him. Why? Because he spoke the truth bluntly, as Ogun must do. Toussaint spoke the truth, but Toussaint, as a Legba, they tell you Legba is the diplomat. Legba will speak in symbolism. Legba will not say, I'm going out of this room. Legba will say, well, my time is almost over. Well, I think soon I should be outside. Da-da-da-da, he turns around. That's a Legba speaking. But then Ogun says, what the hell are you doing here? Ooh. Action and word and action. And the truth is always, no, these white folks, we gotta get rid of them. What is this? We're not gonna stay in slavery no more. Toussaint never said that. Toussaint says, well, the situation is difficult. Slavery is a very hard thing. We must try to do something to eliminate slavery. Not those slavers. That is Legba. It is normal that he speaks that way. That's his role. And it is normal that Dessaline speaks the way he spoke. Legba has to do his work if Ogun is to come on the scene and be able to do his work. It's not a question of Toussaint was no good, he's a so-and-so nigga or whatever, and Dessaline wasn't. No, each had a role to play. Because life is a continuing flow, so is history. And unless each person takes care of what they're supposed to take care of and do what they're supposed to do, we handicap the one coming behind us. No matter how ready our children may be to eliminate certain situations that are here now, if we, the parents, don't do our share, they will be blocked. If we don't create opportunity for them to pass, how will they go? So Toussaint came and did his work as a good, perfect Legba, operating with a dominant Legba. Dessaline shows up on the scene with a perfect Ogun. All obstacles must be eliminated. The objective must be reached in a time established by me. That's Ogun speaking. And they don't like the Ogun black man. They're more comfortable with Legba black men. But don't worry, Legba black men has their work to do. We don't need them to change. We need them to be themselves. The worst thing we can have is a Legba trying to pretend to be an Ogun, or an Ogun trying to pretend to be a Legba. Be who you are and do your show. So Dessaline comes in, people scream, says, well, too many white folks here. Gotta get rid of that. We can't have independence that way. My goodness, he's so brutal. But nobody's coming. In the entire revolution, when you put all the Frenchmen, all the British, all the Spanish, all the Portuguese, all the people from Holland.
All the Dutch.
Who came to enslave us in Haiti? Only 200,000 of them died. Only. Dessalines allowed over 80,000 French troops to leave Haiti and go to France. You tell me he's a brutal man? I say you a fool. You don't understand nothing. You don't know nothing about no science and you know nothing about mathematics. You don't even know arithmetic. Because if you had your arithmetic, your facts right, you would know that 450 million Africans were slaughtered during that period. And when you put 450 million against 200,000, you don't have no situation that is barely balanced.
Mm, right. Raise your hopes.
And as a matter of fact, I would even be tempted to say, Dessalines can do the job right. Because had he done it, had he gone far enough with the job, we wouldn't be dealing with what we're doing now.
Speak on it.
Ogun. Ogun is married to whom, we said?
Oshun.
Oshun is what?
Love.
And love is balance, equilibrium, nurturing, providing. And let's look at Dessalines' wife. Marie Claire Heureuse Félicité Bonheur Dessalines. That's the name of one woman. And the one woman whose father named, while he had chains around his neck, irons around his wrist and around his ankles. When he left the woman pregnant, since he was often put into chains because he wasn't a very docile slave, he said to his woman, if the child is born before I return, please don't name it until I see it. So when she was born, the mother called her girl. And she was almost 7 when her father was released from his iron bars and came to see his child for the first time. And when he saw her, he took her out, presented her to the universe, and said that in his chain he thought of her name. He knew it was a girl. He never had a name for a boy. And he named her Marie Claire Heureuse Félicité. And when we look at the meaning of those names, Marie is French, but comes from the Aramaic Miriam, which means the flesh which allows the infinity to experience time, the temple. That's why in most religion, they will name the mother of God Mary, as you say in English. Okay? Claire, which means that which the one who sends out light allows others to see. Claire. Heureuse, which means happy. One who gives happiness, who invites happiness. Félicité, one who experiences continuous, uninterrupted contentment and satisfaction. That's what this man, enchained, named his child, who will become the first lady of the first freed land in 5,000 years of history. And you think things like this happen by chance? No. And who is this woman with all this name? Her Okay, I told you her first names, right? Now, life will have it, circumstances will have it. She stays with one slaver, 15, 16 years. He ran into financial problems. He sold her without ever making any papers for her. So he just sells her with her four first names. But he sells her to whom? To Mr. Bonheur, which means happiness. So she receives as a last name, Bonheur. Fine. She's going to meet Monsieur Petit, which means small, with a white man who's going to be crazy about her and buy her five times the price she's worth. And when they bring her at night to this Monsieur Petit, because once white man buys you, don't have too many things to say or do with you, you got only one. So they bring her that night to Monsieur Petit, and she says to this man, "It's true, I am your fan. It's true you bought me, and you have the power and the strength to do anything you want with me. But if you would like to know the woman who lives here, then you will marry me." The man, they say, was stunned, because slaves never raise their eyes to look at the slaver. And here is the slave woman I just bought, very expensive, I might add. And she's going to talk about marrying, and besides, it's against the law. But somehow, they say with her quiet, soft-spoken voice, the man didn't feel the courage to go any further. Just to take her back. They took her back while he thought how to deal with this. She was brought back several times, and each time with the same peaceful strength, she would pose her conditions. And in the end, the man paid the judge and married her. He barely lived 8 months. He died 8 months later. She owned everything he had. She'd already purchased her mother and father from slavery and had a fantastic library. He was a painter, all the paintings and whatnot. That's the life of this woman whose name, you see, the father named Marie Claire Heureuse Félicité. Powerful names put together. Sounds are not just sounds. Be careful what you name your children. This woman is going to later on, so after the death of this white man, she decides what she wants to do with her life. She has means now. She doesn't like war. She doesn't like fighting. A lot of women went into the revolution. She wouldn't be any part of it. Have nothing to do with weapons. She says what she will do, her mission is, she will go on the battlefields after the battle. Because the custom at the time was, if you cannot get up and walk away from the battlefield, you are considered dead. It may be that just somebody fell on you or a horse fell on you and you can't get up. But nobody's going to look at you. Once the battle is over, everybody that can walk walks out and the rest stays there. So she decides that's her job. She will go on the battlefield, separate the living from the dead. Go under, she's a very thin woman. Go under this huge big man, pick them up, put them on her wagon. She had a special slanted wagon that she had made. And brought these people, pile them up on her wagon, take them home, and take care of them. She had fantastic talents in taking and giving help with leaves and trees and flowers, natural. And that's how this woman lived for a number of years. Until 1801, when she met on a battlefield Jean-Jacques Dessalines. He came back to analyze why the battle went the way it went down. And he saw this woman dragging man onto a wagon. He went to help her. They started to talk. He fell in love. proposed to marry. He says, no, I don't want to marry. Because I've given myself a mission. I want to help the man left on the battlefield for dead. He says, well, I'm Jean-Jacques Dessalines, the time general. If you marry me, you'll be in a better position to do this. He says, no. Usually when women are married, they're unable to do certain things. He says, no, I give you my word. You can do anything you want when you're married to me. He convinced her. She says, but you're going to sign a contract. Marrying you leaves me free to think, speak, and act according to my convictions. Marrying you will not, your enemies will not automatically become my enemies. That's all right. That's all, isn't it? She had 4 points, but the last one blew away. No, how can I? I'm running for, this is a revolution for independence. How could my enemies be your friends? Well, then we cannot get married. And then Desmond said, okay. She wrote the text. She signed. She said, sign here. Desmond said, you know, don't know how to write. This is okay. I'll teach you. Take your cross. But when he got married, he signed his name. This is love. And he respected this woman, and this woman respected her man. He was strength, and she was the balance formula that kept strength from going overboard, that brought justice in the life of Dessalines. There are several examples to this, but when we look at Marie-Claire Rose, Félicité Bonheur, Dessalines, we see pure Oshun in operation. Those principles are not there as something out there spooky for us to admire. They are for us to know ourselves. When you learn the principles, then you look at yourself and try to see who you are naturally. All of them are in us, but there is a dominant principle. Once you identify your dominance, the dominant principle in you, you have identified your strength. And those that are not dominant in you are your weaknesses. So now you're going to build them up. Don't say, I'm a no-go. It's okay that I just push all the time. No. Yes, in certain situations, that's it. But you have to also learn to be a lepa. You have to also learn to be a Oshun. Don't say, I'm a man, I can be no Oshun. You need to be a Oshun. You need to be an Aizan. We need to develop every principle in ourselves. That's what will make us strong. Am I going to see when I see a 3-year-old child crying who needs a little affection and care, I'm going to say, I'm going to shoot, I'm going to whoop, so I'm going to, what's the matter with your child? No. I need to be a shoot, no matter what. So each situation, I'm going to learn that's what's going to make my strength. In this situation, I know that I need to be a shoot. Here, I need to be a goo. Here, I need to be legba. That's what will make me strong. And at every moment, I'm operating on strength. Not pretending. Operating on what is best for that situation, for this particular time. Remember, to be right is to be the right person, in the right place, at the right time, operating on the right principle.
That's
yes. If you have all the first three and the last one is wrong, you mess it all up. In order to do this, we must look into ourselves. You can't be functioning with yourself day in and day out and you don't know who you are. You don't know what is your dominant trait. When I'm going in a debate, for example, with someone, that you've heard, who am I? What is dominant? Take a guess. What do you see? Huh? What do you say? Somebody said something. Huh? Ogu. What do you say? What do you say? I'm Ogu dominant. That's true. Knowing that, when I'm going to have a debate or I'm having a discussion with someone, I know that I will have a tendency to want to do everything quickly and powerfully. I said, no, this is not a battlefield right now. This is you and your man. Take time, give him a break. And you know he can't go as fast as you do. He ain't no good, but who is quick? I gotta give the other person a chance to, then we can have a discussion. Otherwise, when I was very young, I would just frighten people. I come in so strong, people are just afraid, and then no discussion. That's it. And it's, this woman is a tyrant. It's true. We gotta look at things for what they are. We can't be afraid of ourselves. And we have to understand the other ones looking at you. Of course, an Oshun character looking at an Ogu personality will say, boy, I can't deal with this one. This one is just too. See, we have to. And that's your strength when you know. So when I know I'm going to deal with this type of character, then I have to take a little bit of develop, shine up my Oshun personality, and then come in. See, at some point, Ogu may have to take over. That all depends how things are. But I'm going to give Oshu, I'm going to give Legba, I'm going to give Aizan all the opportunities to talk to you first. And I'm going to hold back on Ogu, because I know he's always there. The others, I have to work at it to bring them out. It's not natural. So, but if I did not know, I would constantly be in shock with everybody. It's very important to know who you are. Know your strength. Know your weaknesses. Don't be afraid. As an Ogu, I naturally speak loud. Ogu brings thunder. Yes. But in recent years, with maturity, I've learned to also learn to speak soft. That's when I bring my little Oshuna. And everybody's okay with, you know, they feel more comfortable with this one. But be careful, if you mess up, you're going to come out.
That's right.
And I'm not responsible for what it does. No belief system is worth anything if it does not bring you to improve your life. The reason we're here is to make each day better than the one before. If we're not on that path, then we don't need to be here. What we believe in is no good. Something's wrong with our belief system. We need to question it, throw it out, get something else.
That's right.
If you're into something and it's not taking you anywhere, why in the world are you gonna stay in it? No. You didn't come to the earth to suffer, believe me. The stuff they told us in the church, that we came here because, you know, we have to suffer and pay our sins. No, I don't know for somebody else, but you and I, brothers and sisters, we don't have no sin, no original sin to pay. Guaranteed. We have no original sin to pay. And what is worse, look at those criminals who ate 400 going through all the stuff we're going through? So why should I pay for some original sin when the everyday sinner is paying for nothing? No. You have no original sin or your slate is clean. The divine lives in you. You don't need to go anywhere to meet with God. Just look in the mirror. Trust in yourself. Learn to know yourself. Take time to know yourself, to meet yourself, to dialogue with you. Yes, some people, if they see you, will say, that woman is crazy. That's okay. Keep on. I talk to my mom all the time. Pull her coat when she's acting stupid. Clap for her when she does something nice. Yeah. But I always know, as a human, she's going to act stupid sometimes, no matter what, no matter how long she lives. But I don't get upset. I just, you know, tell her, hey, listen, girl, this number here, you don't need to do it again. Yeah. And I keep on going. I'm not going to go through any traumatizing, going through all kind of, oh my goodness, I did, oh, no. There's one word, only one, something the Bible says that I'm interested in repeating. It says, know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Yeah. And that's the truth.
Yeah.
You did something stupid? Don't beat up on yourself. Just pick it up. Hey, listen, girl, this year, that's no good. You know you shouldn't have done that. You talk to yourself, you face up to the fact that you did something stupid, and that's the end of that. You go on about your business. No tears necessary. No, slam up, put them up. You don't need all this. No. Take hold of your life. When you see somebody, identify who they are. If it's an ugu, don't put yourself in their way. Because he will identify you as an obstacle and you will be eliminated. Generally, you stand on the side when talking to a group. You don't stand in his way. As a matter of fact, intelligent people don't stand in the way of any force. You take a position to leave their path, leave.
Thank you. How you should do this today? Thank you.
So, identify the principles in all things. When you read a book, you don't need to memorize all 378 pages. You want to get the essence. What is it this person wants to say? You want to grab hold of the essence of that book, or the speech, or the talk, or whatever. And then you want to take that in the essence. What is it in there that can serve me to build good character? I'm going to go with that. All the rest does not matter. Not to me. Because when somebody writes a book, 378 pages, millions of people are going to read it. There is something in there for each of them. All of it is not for you. The essence is for us all. But the details, there's only one detail for me. Maybe one detail in there for me. I want to find that one. Well, hold of it, improve my character, and go on about my business. I don't need to know everything they said by heart. You imagine in IET, so-called historians, writing about Jean-Jacques Dessalines to Saint-Louverture and not knowing anything about Verdun. So of course they're constantly in a battle. You know, this historian is pro-Louverture. This historian is pro-Dessalines. So the one who's pro-Dessalines tell you Louverture was a field nigger or house nigger, I don't know what. The other one tells you it's something else. Neither one understanding anything. role is to identify their strength and use it to improve our present. We don't care if Martin Luther King had a girlfriend. That's his business.
Right.
That's not what we want from him. He's
right.
gone. We respect his memory and we want to grab what he had of positive. And we want to hold on to that to improve today. Elijah Muhammad, he brought many things for us. We don't need to sit down and have debate and denigrating him. No. We want to, the man knew how to organize. Who was he? Elijah. Aizan. Yes. He knew how to organize. That's what we want from him. Yes. The rest, we don't care. Malcolm X.
You're too great, brother.
You must be all to yourself. Yes. Malcolm was on boo. So we want to catch that strength, that truth, that justice that he had in him. The rest, we don't care. Don't let people, what basically the colonizers, what they do. With our leaders. When they first come on the scene, of course there'll always be those who attack them, but the wiser ones don't attack them. In fact, they put them up on a pedestal. They tell us, this man is God. This man is divine. This man is, you know, they up and up. And they put him up so high. And the rest of us say, yeah, that's right. He's God. He's divine. He's everything white men say. That's true. And you know what happens? When that leader does little tripping, he's the devil. Because when you were God, you can't be anything in between. Once you no longer go, when you make the slightest mistake, you're the devil. And if you go on with that, you'll constantly be pro so-and-so, and then against the same so-and-so. No, just tell yourself all the time. The pharaohs in Egypt had a practice. The pharaoh had to have a, what you call very short people? A dwarf. Thank you.
A dwarf.
No. They had to have a dwarf walking around the pharaoh all the time and telling the pharaoh when people are clapping and saying, yeah, great pharaoh, you are God on earth, great pharaoh, there's great pharaoh. And the dwarf will pull his and say, remember, you're just human. It was an excellent practice. Kept the pharaoh balanced. Keep him from going crazy in his head. This is necessary for the people. In order to motivate us, we need to have somebody in front of us that we give a kind of praise to. Yes, it's good for us, but it's bad for them that we give the praise to. So the dwarf is there to remind him, hey, this here is just a joke, don't take it seriously. You're just a human being. You're just a human being. Very important. We have to do that for ourselves. We have to be the person who's being clapped and be our own dwarf. Telling ourselves all the time, don't take it seriously. You're just a human. And if you do this, then it will keep you from going back and forth to on your position with different people. Like right now in IET, a lot of people who saw Aristide as God are now seeing him as the devil. But I loved him before, and I still love him. He's only human. He did what he could, and he failed at certain things. That's human. I don't have to turn him into a devil for that. Protect ourselves. Knowledge. Love cannot exist without knowledge. You cannot love yourself if you don't know who you are. You must know this here that we see, and you must know the you that we don't see. There is a you that only you can know. You need to know this you. Go meet her. Go meet him. Have a dialogue. And together, you and you, make a plan for a better life. Make a plan for a life of victory. Remember, your plan will be worth nothing if it's not a plan that will benefit the nation. Serve each other. There is no shame in it. In fact, Dessalines once was asked, he asked, what is power? And people gave big speeches on what is power. But Dessalines' power is the ability to serve those who are around you. He went further and said, on the plantation, nobody knew me. I was a slave like all the other slaves. Until one day, the slavers put some brothers to the iron with no food for so many days. And me, that day, I was served two boiled sweet potatoes. So I took one, I cut it in two pieces, took the other, cut it in two more pieces. I stuffed one piece, I washed out, stuffed one piece in one brother's mouth, stuffed one piece in another brother's mouth, and I ate the last one. From that day on, I became somebody on the plantation. I was never seen as a slave like all the others. This is my second step up. I was witness to certain slaves who did something. And when the master came asking who did it, they knew I saw who did it. But I refused to speak. So they tied me up and whipped me for several hours. I never spoke. In the end, they decided I was too good a worker for them to lose. So they stopped the beating. But for all the others who witnessed this, who knew that I knew who had done it, and those guys were not even my friends, I became someone else. Anything but not a slave. You see, power doesn't wear any particular garment. Power is something within. You have it. It cannot be given to you. You develop it through your actions, not your words. You can walk bare feet. You can have no house and be the most powerful person. No one can make you do what you don't want to do. And everyone dealing with you will recognize you as a powerful person. Powerful person with no money in their pocket. Yes. But powerful. Courage has nothing to do with money. Truth has nothing to do with money. Building good character has nothing to do with money. So if we are going to value ourselves according to how much money we have, we're going to be in very bad shape. And when you will have accumulated all the money there is, you will feel so miserable. You will be looking for a poor person to do something for your morale. You will be envying beggars in the street. I'm sure each one of us here knows somebody who seems to have everything and yet is the most miserable person that you know. So that cannot be an objective in somebody's life. Accumulation of things? No. But at the same time, you don't have to be afraid of wealth. Wealth cannot make you. If a lot of wealth comes to you, it shouldn't change your character. It should not change your purpose in life. Because you're still looking to build good character. Each day better than the next one. So you can't sit down and say, well, I was very good. Yesterday I gave to the poor. On Sunday I put in the church. So I'm a good person. I don't need to do anything else anymore. Sorry, that's not a good person. No, it's each day. What did you do today to make your life a better life than yesterday? Thinking is an action verb. It's an action word. You don't think just like that. No. Thinking is a process. You have to sit down and decide, I'm going to think about this. This is a problem. What kind of solution? I think on it for an hour today. I don't find a solution. That's okay. I'll think on it an hour tomorrow. I'll think on it another hour next week. There is no guarantee that because you spent 2 minutes saying, well, how do I pay my rent? Oh boy, there's no solution, that's for sure. No, thinking is a process. And if you don't have the habit of thinking, you don't know how to think. Don't fool yourself. Just because words or images go through your mind, it does not mean you are thinking. To think, you need silence. You need to know what you're thinking about. You need to understand the process within yourself. If you can't do all of this, you are not thinking. Don't tell lies to yourself. And it's important. We need to teach ourselves to think. Because you can't find solutions to problems if you're unable to think. And, Vodou. Through Vodou, our ancestors gave us the fundamental principles. The work is easy now. If they tell us fire in this room, what are we going to do here? All of us run to the door? Huh? I didn't hear anything. You're going to try and put it out. And the rest of us are going to sit in here and wait until you put it out.
First thing,
we're leaving.
Come over to the planet, evacuate, get the people out of here.
We need two several people operating at the same time. We are many of us in here. All of us are not going to do the same thing. A legba should rise up immediately and create the space for us to get out, to get the children, the weak, the sick, out quickly. All of us will be led by us in certain ways. Because we're not going to try to push this brother here or push this one here to get, no. I want to create a space for you to go through. You want to create a space for her to go through. He wants to create a space for her to go through. We all want to go. And Aizan's going to be saying, to the right, all the women line up this way, all the men this way. gonna hear and obey. It's not a dictatorship. That's organization. Even though the master dictator has conditioned us to believe when a black man gives an order, it is a dictator. But when a white man tells you what to do right into your bedroom, it's okay. No. Black men must tell us what to do. Black women must tell us what to do. And we have to learn to obey each other. We are here, Brother Inouye is the general. If anything is going down here, we want to hear what he's got to say. And we're not all going to talk when he's talking. We're going to have enough discipline that when Ogu over there tell us, ladies, put up sisters this way, brothers that way, and we're going to do exactly what he's going to say. Unless we see that there is something else he did not see, then we're going to send that information to him. We must understand this. Life is organization. Just look at your body. You think the heart is going to say one of these days, if your heart was to say, okay, I'm tired of this pumping blood here. I never get to taste the food. Pumping blood is boring. The lungs are going to say, well, you know, I've been pumping air all this time. Now it's time for me to taste a little wine. It is an organization, well structured. Each person has something, or each organ has something very specific to do. When one organ stops doing what it is supposed to do, it creates chaos for the entire system. 99% of our problems, we don't control our mind. Our mind is supposed to control everything. But we decide, we operate, we don't decide, we just exist this way. Oh, I see this is good. Hamburger, hot dog, cha-cha-cha, cha-cha-cha, something chewing all the time. No control. Your mind has to control. Mind has to take over. Mind has to say when mouth is going to taste something. And when mind says no, it's no. You have to organize here. That's the first universe. If we can control this universe here, ain't nothing we're going to control. We cannot control this room. Sorry. Got to operate here. Control this. Yeah. Brother's good looking. I like him. He looks good. I can imagine all kind of wonderful things we could do together. But I have a mission in my life. Can he contribute to my mission? Can he advance and help me advance in what I have as an objective? All the good-looking guys in the world can't do that for me. So I'm not going to be involved with this brother when he cannot contribute to what is important into my life. My life is not my body. So sometimes we have to make a choice. Yeah, that would be good in the mouth, but it would be bad for the heart. So the mind is going to decide, but it's not going in the mouth. Yeah, I'd love to taste some of that, but it will be bad for my tension, for my hypertension, for my blood pressure, for my... Then it's not going to go in my mouth. Mind is a general, and it decided what it says goes. Don't tell me, oh, I just didn't notice when it went into my mouth. What? You know that's a lie. And you see, if you can't control this little world here, you don't even need to deal with spiritual. Spiritual is out. Spiritual is out. Gotta master the physical. That's your first step. You want to be strong spiritually? That's why, what do you see? in every kind of convent or structure where people go to develop their spirituality. They fast, they exercise, they do all kinds of things with their body in order to control. If you don't have any control over this here, you're not going to have control over anything. So don't even talk about spirituality until you control this. Master this. Then the rest will be easy. Yes, yes. You're right. It's time for me to stop talking and give other people a chance. I agree with you. On this note, I listen to the youngest member of this assembly and I shut my mouth. Permission, young lady. We do have this, a lecture. In fact, I wrote the lecture for yesterday, but I never read it. And today again, I came with it, but I didn't read it. So other things had to come out. But the lecture is available in the back.
Sisters and brothers, I think that the experience we've just shared here is a little different. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
And of course, this comes out of a tradition. Can you come in, please? Susan, Sister Baina, can you come in, please? You know, if you look at our flyer, you'll see that over the past couple of years, we've lost a couple of brothers. And what we're doing is just celebrating the life of our brothers, Amos Wilson and James. So, just keep them in your prayers, keep them in your memory, because these are two brothers who served us and gave up much by way of sacrifice. So we've honored them by just noting them on our flyers. You notice that Amos Wilson passed on the 14th of January in 95, and James almost a year to the day, a year ago. So please keep these brothers in memory. But at the same time, whilst we're celebrating the contributions of those brothers, we're going to celebrate two birthdays today. And these are the individuals who whose birthdays we're going to celebrate. Now, these are two hard-working individuals. I guess this is the Earl of Haiti, and this is the Bain of No, these are two hard-working folks. And now it makes sense. Everything Everything evolves, doesn't it? Everything makes sense. Everything makes sense, doesn't it? So on behalf of all of us, happy birthday. Sister Baina's birthday was last Tuesday.
Yes.
And Earl's birthday will be this Tuesday. Oh, no, it's not my birthday. One in South Africa. And hopefully by then, the brothers will take care of business in Zaire.
Yes, sir.
I hope that they do catch that scumbag Mobutu and deal with him, irrespective of the fact that, you know, he has Serbs protecting him now. First it was the Israelis, and now he has Serbs. But I don't care who he gets. When his time is up, it's up. Time's up, yeah. So there are flyers at the back. Any other announcements? I know you have questions, so are you ready to go again, Baina?
Yes, sir.
You don't have a question, you have a statement.
A question. I'll wait till she's
done. Okay, so let's welcome back our sister, Baina.
Thank you for your informative lecture. I have a question concerning cults. How does one try not to become involved in a cult, and what is a cult?
Okay. That's a very, very interesting question. You see, we have to look at connotations, and then we have to look at meaning. Those who have the media power to tell people whatever they want, have the power to call anything that they don't like, don't approve of, that does not serve their purpose, any sets of belief that does not serve their purpose, to baptize it a cult, and that way keeping a certain number of people away from it. But in as far as I am concerned, in my own belief, my own mind, all religions, don't forget we said, religion is the business of selling that which you cannot see. All religions have their cults, have their little pockets and corner, because as any belief, okay, if we take Christians, Catholics, Christians come up, they say, okay, God's name is Jesus, and Mary, and Joseph, and this, and this, and that. Within this group, another group broke up and said, well, we don't agree with the Mary part. So they form a different group that believe in all of the above except Mary. Then within another group is going to split up again and say, okay, well, we just want to accept the Pope in Rome. That business of Pope in Rome, that's out. King, religious king or president, out. We don't want that. So you will have the Episcopalian. You will have another group that will come and say this, this, and that. If the group, when it first break out, they are all called cults by the main group. If the group grows, have enough followers, it grows and becomes important, they will stop calling it cult, it will become a religion. If it never becomes very important in number of people, and of course, finance, because number of people mean finance, okay, then it will remain a cult. So we don't have to enter his set role of set code Okay? People create different belief sets, the sets of belief or way of functioning or believing all over the world, all the time. In any one place in Africa, you can find 10,000 different expressions of the same basic principles. Are they cults? No, they're not cults. That's just the way that they view things. Because what it is, in the end, is your conception of the universe, how the world was created, who's the ultimate power. It's all dealing with the same thing. So people can, depending on their situation, they will create every kind of belief that they want. And they are free to do it. The only thing they're not free to do is to impose it on other people. Okay? So, whatever somebody believes, I'm not one who's going to call your belief a cult. I'm not even going to call it a religion either. Because I don't know if you're doing a business with it. If I observe that it's a big business, then I will call it a religion. But otherwise, I will just say that is your belief and I have no problem with you. Okay? So we're not going to enter into this word game.
Okay?
Okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, yes, I wanted to know, what was your opinion on Shaka Zulu? They had it on Channel 9 it was Thursday and Friday. They said he was one of the strongest warriors ever.
Remember what we said earlier. All of our ancestors, all those who came before us, who fought to improve our lives, we owe them respect. When we learn about them, we want to take their strength, and the rest is of no interest to us. Yes, indeed, Shaka Zulu was a great black man. What is important for me to know? He was a great black man living in South Africa who attempted to avoid having the whites come and occupy the land. That he failed is not important to me. What is, when I'm studying him, I want to know his strength. This is a man of character. That is important. A good warrior, certainly. A man who believes in building your body. Because when they're talking about he forbid his soldiers to wear shoes because their feet would become soft. Or when the shoes broke off, then you were handicapped on the battlefield. Whereas if you were fighting bare feet, your feet were accustomed to stepping on everything, and so you had no problem of something breaking while you were fighting. So to me, that makes sense. This is a man who wanted to build the kind of body that was necessary for the actions that he was leading. As far as the film is concerned, I am sure there is a great deal in it that I will have to close my eyes to, close my mind, and especially close my heart to. When we look at who wrote it, when we look at who directed it, when we look at who chose who did what and how things were done, I will have to take a lot of distance with this. But basically, if you're asking me about the personality, Shaka Zulu, I say a great black man who attempted to bring his stone into the construction of black folks. I have no problem.
All right.
No questions? I did a very bad job.
Oh no.
Well, y'all, it is a chronic concept of Amenabil Gaia. We believe in the unseen. I mentioned this particular concept. I want you to expand on the notion of what you're talking about, the unseen or unseen beings, spirituality, and also I want some of your comments on nutrition, because there are some scholars who talk in such a way that you can listen, that spirituality or anything that they can't see. In terms of this, anything they can't see they seem to have some sort of a Eurocentric thing that's not existing. They seem to divorce spirituality and nutrition from their outlook on life. So I'd like you to speak somewhat to extend or expand somewhat more on unseen beings from an Afrocentric perspective. Also, could you say something also in terms of nutrition and diet?
Well, I'm not certain, it's not totally clear what you're looking for. But from what I've gathered, you are wondering what is my concept when you're talking about what is unseen. What is unseen is all that we cannot see and yet we know is. If I say, it's fine for those who want to say that yes, all is or sun, just with fact, this man meets this woman, the egg, the sperm, da-da-da-da, so many degrees, so many hours, pregnancy, a child will come. Okay, you want to tell me it's just that? Fine. But I know. I don't say I think. I say I know that there is more to life than that which I see. And when we study the biography of various so-called great intellectuals who prone this non-existence of something other than matter, that matter is all there is in this world, those who prone this belief, we find that when they are sick, when they are dying, they call for people who are experts on the unseen. Example, what's the name of this guy? French, Jean-Paul Sartre. Very famous man for talking, there's nothing but what he can see, that everything is what we see, there is nothing more to it. So, well, when he was dying, he sent for a priest to give him extra unction. Okay. I agree that he wrote wonderful books about matter, but he also had relationships with all kinds of people, and he talked about he loved, and he talked about he feels, and he talked about a lot of things that he cannot show me. Therefore, his whole theory about matter is it. He has demonstrated is not. Number one. If we were to give one more example, there's also Margaret Mead, big-time anthropologist, who did a lot of harm to the people of Samoa through her books, denigrating their different belief systems. Well, when she was dying of cancer, it so happened that life put me there as a, I was at the American Museum as a public relations officer. And when she was in the hospital, she was asking for Hunga and voodoo doctors and all kinds of people when she felt that death was there. She no longer trusted in her great science. So, you know, we have a lot of examples. We may not be able, we can of course, if I say I believe in the unseen, I cannot show you that which is unseen. But then I am comfortable saying I feel, I believe, I have a sensation, I have a premonition. I can use a whole lot of things. I am free to do this, and it's correct that I have these verbs in my vocabulary. But if you tell me that unseen does not exist, then you cannot tell me about you think, because thinking, you cannot see. You believe, you cannot believe. Just show me what you're talking about, don't talk to me about what you believe. Since matter is all there is. So you see, they quickly run into problem. Those who've gone, when you're thinking, when you're not being conditioned by their words, you can very easily demonstrate, they cannot demonstrate that matter is all there is. Okay? Now as far as nutrition. Nutrition, listen, we have this little machine here they have entrusted to us to care and cherish. It's almost like a marriage. The spirit in the body, marriage. And we're supposed to use our power to reason, which is unseen, our power to think, our power to reflect, all of these are unseen powers. We must use them to treat this body as it should be in order to get the best and the most out of it. If I control what I eat and I observe myself to know what, it's not just I read in a book, lettuce is good for you, so I'm going to eat lettuce morning, noon, and night. No. If lettuce is good for me, I'm going to eat lettuce and see how my body reacts to lettuce. Lettuce may be very good, but not good for this particular body. So I must eat lettuce and look at what happened to this body. And there is a constant dialogue. We must not be afraid of facts. When I eat, I'm going to urinate. I'm going to defecate. These are information, vital information, for me to know what's going on with my body. The minute I go, I look at what happened, and it's going to tell me something about what's going on in here. There is something that you eat. You should know the natural color of your urine. I cannot know it. You have to know it. The doctor cannot know it either. You, and only you, can know the natural color of your urine, the natural color of your feces. Now, once I go, and I always check what's happening, as soon as I see the color changing, I feel the temperature changing, I feel the texture changing, I know something is wrong. Then I must look at what did I put in my mouth. I have to go back in history. Gotta have history.
Yes, ma'am.
Go back, check out what did I put in my mouth. Now I'm going to see, I ate this and I have this. Something is wrong there, okay. I'm not gonna eat this for 3 days and observe what happened. I see that everything went back to normal. Now on the fourth day, I'm gonna eat a little bit of it again. The thing that I didn't eat for 3 days. And I'm going to see if this particular thing brings this particular reaction. If it changes what is normal, then something is wrong. It's going to, in the long run, bring you some serious harm. It's going to do you some serious harm. And it's not because you don't go to the doctor, doesn't mean you're not sick. You may not have any major symptoms, but you have things that are doing little harm continuously, and they're building up. Then you also have to know your reaction to pain. Certain people, like Ogu folks, don't feel pain. My teeth will totally spoil, turn rotten, and eat up the gums in my mouth, and I don't feel it. Somebody else, before there is a real carry, will already be crying about a toothache. I won't. I have problem when I'm having a baby because I don't feel the pain. I can't tell. I need to let the child go. I have to develop a sense about it so I can go to the hospital. So I will have, I will carry many problems. If I'm not careful with myself, I will not look for solutions. Whereas somebody else who's more sensitive, as soon as there's a tiny little problem in the tooth, they're gonna go to the dentist. They're gonna find out. They're gonna be able to do something about it very early. You see, so you have to know all this about you. That's the best way to keep yourself healthy. You have to know, when I'm wearing 125 pounds, is that good for me? Do I feel good? Do I walk up the stairs with no problem? When I'm wearing 145 pounds, don't read what they say in the book, that a woman your height should be this and that. They have determined that for themselves. It has nothing to do with you. You need to find out what your thing is. I will never say to somebody, you're too big, you're too small, you're too this, you're too that. No. I don't know how she feels. I don't know how she's handling the weight that she's carrying. I know some very, very big people who are much lighter on their feet than I am. They run up the stairs and they do all kinds of things that I can't do. But it's important for you to know what is right for you. If you're wearing a weight that as soon as you take 4 or 5 steps, you go, you need to check it out.